Hi everyone, welcome to our video. Today, we will be discussing the notorious period. Almost all women must deal with the trials and tribulations of menstruation at some point in their lives. The cramping, aching, and seemingly never-ending bleeding have been familiar but dreaded sensations to women all over the world since the beginning of humanity. But though we may understand how our body is feeling during that time of the month, there is a lot more going on behind the scenes. So, how does menstruation work? We asked Hannah and Rebecca of Bleed Free McMaster, a club on McMaster campus dedicated to tackling menstrual stigmas and barriers, to help us deconstruct the period.
Well, to start off, after hitting puberty, every woman enters a constant cycle that continues until menopause. This cycle is called the menstrual cycle, and on average runs for a span of 28 days. The menstrual cycle works through a series of hormones that are released in the body at three key centers: the hypothalamus of the brain, the anterior pituitary, and the ovaries. To begin the cycle, a hormone called gonadotropin-releasing hormone, or GnRH, is released from the hypothalamus. This hormone acts on the anterior pituitary by stimulating the gland to release two new hormones, follicle-stimulating hormone, or FSH, and luteinizing hormone, or LH. FSH and LH travel down the bloodstream until they reach the ovaries, which are their main site of action. These hormones are extremely important for the growth of eggs within the ovary.
FSH stimulates the development of the follicle within the ovary, which is a sac that contains the immature egg cell. The sac is composed of granular cells called granulosa, which produce the steroid hormone estrogen. LH, on the other hand, triggers the egg to be released from the follicle sac, causing ovulation to occur. Ovulation is essentially just egg being released from the ovary and down the uterine tube. After ovulation, the leftover cells from the follicle become known as the corpus luteum. At this point, LH acts on the corpus luteum to promote the production of the steroid hormone progesterone within it. Estrogen and progesterone are the two key hormones which control what happens to the female endometrium, or in other words, the lining of the uterus that is shed during menstruation.
Altogether, these hormones regulate each other using a mechanism called negative feedback. To explain how negative feedback works, let's imagine that you are hungry. When you're hungry, your body tells you it wants to eat. As you eat, the food in your stomach starts to tell your body to slow down and the hunger begins to die down. Eventually, you stop eating because your body is telling you that you don't need any more food. Although we aren't conscious of it, the same sort of thing is happening in our bodies with our hormones. GnRH, FSH, and LH can be thought of as the food for the ovaries, and estrogen and progesterone are just like the signals that tell the body to stop eating when it has had enough. Eventually, once all the estrogen and progesterone has been metabolized in the liver, the cycle repeats itself, just the same as the way our body tells us that we are hungry again once we have digested all our food. So, while GnRH, FSH, and LH stimulate the production of estrogen and progesterone, estrogen and progesterone inhibit the release of GnRH, FSH, and LH.
Let's talk more about the endometrium, which is essentially what the period is all about. The endometrium is the outer layer of the uterus that is shed during menstruation. There are three key phases of the menstrual cycle, which are seen within the endometrium. The first is the proliferative phase. The proliferative phase occurs after menstruation and before ovulation. We will say that day 4 to 7 of the menstrual cycle marks the beginning of this phase. The proliferative phase lasts until day 14 and is characterized by the rapid growth of the endometrium. Typically, at the start of the proliferative phase, the endometrium is only 2 millimeters thick, but by 5 days in, it has grown to 10 millimeters thick. This crazy amount of cell growth is caused by estrogen, which is being released by the follicle in the ovary. Estrogen receptors are expressed within the endometrium and mediate the actions of estrogen.
At day 14, there's a surge in the level of LH, releasing the egg from the follicle and leaving the corpus luteum in its place. This marks the beginning of the second phase of the menstrual cycle, the secretory phase, which occurs from day 14 to day 28. In the secretory phase, progesterone is continuously being released by the corpus luteum. Progesterone stops the growth of the endometrium by significantly lowering the expression of estrogen receptors within its cells. Progesterone also accumulates sugars like glycogen and proteins like collagen, which triggers the endometrial glands to release their contents through secretion and provokes cells to enlarge. The goal here is to create a perfect environment for a fertilized egg implant to develop in, which occurs in the first stages of pregnancy. The effects of progesterone are induced by the presence of progesterone receptors within the endometrium. Around day 28, in the event that pregnancy has not occurred, the body realizes that there is no fertilized egg to be implanted in the uterus, causing the corpus luteum to break down. This results in a decline in progesterone levels. With a lack of progesterone in the uterus, there is nothing to keep the endometrium where it is, so it begins to shed, signaling the start of the menstrual phase, where we begin again at day one.
We hope all the women listening have gained a little bit more of an understanding about what is really going on during their period, and maybe even a little bit more of an appreciation for it. And to the guys out there, just count yourselves lucky. Thanks for listening. Check out our YouTube channel for more interesting videos like this one.